A questo punto invito Rachel Brady a prendere posto. È già pronto il PowerPoint, è tutto a proiezione. Allora, Rachel Brady, docente nella Duke University a Durham in North Carolina. Il titolo del suo intervento è The Utility of 3D Models and Virtual Reality and Research Tools.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for inviting me to come talk to you today. I am going to try and speak slowly for those of you where English is not your native language. Just raise your hand if I start going too fast, and I'll try and remember to slow down again. So my name is Rachel Brady from Duke University. I am actually in the computer science department, the School of Engineering, and I have a courtesy appointment in the Art History Visual Studies department. I work with Carolyn Bruzelius, and we've done some projects with Donatella. So I want to talk a little bit about 3D modeling. And it seems like most people in this room are fairly sophisticated with regards to 3D modeling. Back in the day, and it wasn't very long ago, up until a few years ago, 3D modeling required either programming experience or expertise in a relatively powerful software system, such as AutoCAD or Maya or another 3D modeling system. And I just thought I would show you what it took to draw that square in the upper right corner. If you were to do it in the GL programming language. But nowadays, thanks to tools such as Google SketchUp and Photosynth, creating 3D models are relatively... Should I go closer or farther? I'm too close? It's okay, all right. Are relatively easy and accessible to non-experts. How many people in this room have used Google SketchUp? Okay, how many people in this room have used some other automatic modeling tools such as image-based Photosynth, Photo3D? Okay, so not a lot of 3D modelers in the room, that's okay. Hopefully we're gonna convert you soon to start playing around with it. It's actually quite fun and it's neat to be creative. But what I wanted to say is architecture historians have always sketched and drawn in the process of doing their research. They should, of course, continue to do so with paper and pencil. But moving your sketches onto the computer allows the historian to ask new questions and to take advantages of some of the strengths of computer graphics. So, for example, one of the projects that happened a couple years ago at Duke with some students. Do you want me to speak closer in? Okay. A typical project with 3D models is, of course, to recreate a building. And this is an example of a floor plan of an abbey in Filoni and a picture of one of our undergraduate students, Akira Lee, who has been using Google SketchUp to hypothesize about different elements of the building. How they're designed, how they might change over time, how their roof lines might happen. And in this image, she's actually presenting her ideas to the rest of the class, and because she has this done as a 3D model on a computer, she can spin it around and change her viewpoint to better explain a specific item she wants to explain. This is an example of an animation by another student, Umberto. Just, again, using this simple Google SketchUp tool to illustrate the evolution of this abbey over time, the building of the cloister. We add in some chapels. Notice the students had quite a bit of difficulty trying to figure out a roof line that would work for this building. But this is an example of the typical things that can now be done by students and yourselves as art historians. You no longer need to engage the services of an expert if you choose not to do so. So the affordances of computer graphics, what is this buying you? It buys you an arbitrary viewpoint, so unlike your hand sketches, we can automatically generate perspective and a view from any location that you want. You can generate animations to show either your evolution through time or to show other research results which you've come up with. I think one of the more powerful uses of computer graphics that I was hoping Maurizio might have shown you is you can generate lighting effects of some of these spaces. Of course, back in the day, people relied on candlelight, and many buildings were built with courtyards with the idea of natural light and filling the room with natural light. So you can do an analysis of that with your computer graphics. Again, you have some you can do perspective analysis, such as Andrea showed earlier today, to evaluate the locations and paths of privilege, or understand the decorative elements on buildings. And then finally, because everything is being represented in the computer mathematically, you can do quantitative analysis. You can run simulations. How will water run off that roof? What is the volume of a space? So once a space is constructed, sometimes historians, at least the historians I talk to, really want to consider how a space might be used. Now we might bring in the power of virtual reality and computer gaming engines, because a desktop computer screen cannot necessarily convey the sense of space or majesty and scale that's so necessary when studying the cultural and political implications of religious structures, such as churches and cathedrals. Also, we must populate these places. So far, most of the models we've seen today have been empty spaces. They tend to have been filled, or so I have been told. How did they sound? How did they smell? Who was allowed where? So these are the kinds of things you can start thinking about using virtual reality technologies. I want to take a moment to digress to define what I mean by virtual reality. I run a virtual reality theater back at Duke, and this happens to be a room which is about 3 meter cube, 3 meter by 3 meter by 3 meter. One of the walls slides open, so you can walk in and close the wall behind you, so you cannot see the physical world at all. The only thing you can see is the computer-generated world. And this means that it has limited your cyber sickness you might have heard of, because the computer-generated world does not fall off the edge of the screen. It's a rear-projected stereographic system with ultrasonic tracking. So what is virtual reality? A virtual reality, from a computer science point of view, actually requires four key elements. One is you need to have a virtual world, which is the context of your experience. A virtual world can be viewed any way you choose once you have created it. You can do it on an iPhone, you can look at it through a web page, but the content must be created. Virtual reality needs to convey a sense of immersion. This is hopefully would be both physical immersion through the use of devices and large screens and mental immersion. People claim items such as books are a form of virtual reality because your mind is transported. You need to provide sensory feedback. So as you move and interact with your virtual objects, the system should respond to your movements appropriately. And you need some kind of interactivity. So here's just some pictures for you to see that virtual reality can manifest itself in many different ways on your iPad, on your iPhone. There's a head-mounted displays. You maybe have seen pictures of people wearing these big helmets. The bottom right down here, bottom left, I suppose it is, shows a cave-like system, which is the kind of system I have. But I want to also tell you that in virtual reality, we do privilege the visual usually, but we also try and pay just as much attention to audio, and I'll have a few words about that a little later. And there are many devices that can give you a sense of touch. So haptic feedback is very possible and is used quite widely, particularly in the field of biochemistry. They use touch to do their molecular docking. Also, there is research in the field on smell, which has an implication for taste. So we do actually, I have been through demonstrations where I am making my breakfast and I can smell the eggs and bacon cooking, compliments of technology. There are two other components for the virtual reality technology that are crucial. Besides a large display, you also need to have what's called a tracking system. The Wii system, the Xbox Kinect system, those are both tracking systems. Who here has used a Wii system? Oh, come on. That's better. All right. And who has used a Kinect? Have any of you guys tried the new Kinect system? This is really a very nice system, particularly from a computer scientist's point of view. There's a lot it can do. I think there it is. There's our Kinect system. These are tracking systems, and what they do is they monitor where you as a participant is located relative to the display, what you're doing, what are your gestures. And so these systems keep track of you and allow us to update the system appropriately and give you the sensory feedback that you need. And then, of course, for every 100 virtual reality researchers, there's 101 input devices. So this is just a little showing that you can have very many different ways of interacting with your digital world. It does not have to be through a desktop computer. Within a VR system, some of the things we need to think about now is what are my interaction methods? How am I going to manipulate objects? How am I going to navigate through the space? And do I have interactivity within my virtual world? Does my world have avatars? Do they have some kind of intelligence behind them? And another thing we think a lot about is once you're in a virtual world, it's very nice to be able to build your 3D model within your virtual world instead of doing it on a desktop. So these are some of the things that we think about. And here's a quick video, hopefully it's not too dark, just showing what I'm talking about. So as I move forward in the space, the graphics respond to my movement, and what you're seeing is just the viewpoint being updated. And this next system, a short video, is giving you an idea of object manipulation, which is one of the most, this particular paradigm is the most intuitive. We call it grab and drag. So we take our input device, which this gentleman is holding, and we have a virtual version of your hand, which is the blue sword you see occasionally. And he's picking up and moving objects in a 3D space. And what you're seeing with that double image on this screen is the left eye and the right eye to give you stereo vision. And it is shown time sequentially. And when you make a video of it, it shows as flashing left and right eye, which is why you get a double image for each one. So hopefully this gives you an idea of what it's like to be within one of these systems. I mentioned one of the things you need to have when creating a virtual reality experience is a virtual world. And now that virtual reality systems have been around pretty significantly for about 20 years now, 1990 is kind of when the field took off. There are many, many experiences, historical experiences, being a very popular use of this technology because it allows people to experience the buildings or the historical cities at life size if they so choose. Some of the other things we consider in a virtual experience is we now have all the power of our computer and your digital model. So that means we can add some simulation to that model. We can think about the physics in the world. We don't have to recreate regular physics. We have applications on the moon. We can change the physics to the moon. We can turn things inside out. We also need to think about object co-interaction. Many times, if you pick up an object and move it, do you want it to intersect with the other one in the world, or do you want to pass through? This is now totally under our control. And we also think a lot about what we called world persistence. So for example, if you've played World of Warcraft or done an online game or used Second Life, there is this concept of that world existing after you log out. So this is another consideration that we need to think about. But what can virtual reality offer an architect or an art historian? Well, some of the affordances you get from VR, of course, is a full-scale display. So even though, for example, the dive system that I run is only 3 meters cubed, because of the stereographics, you don't see the physical walls of the system when you're in there. So you can be in a cathedral, which is 10 meters, the space is 10 meters high, and you feel like you're in a space that's 10 meters high. We give you natural gesture interaction, that grab and drag interaction. Walking around objects is actually cognitively different than spinning an object in front of you. We need to consult with our neurobiologists from this morning, but there have been publications on that. And of course, we can give you different simulations, populate the world with avatars, or fill the world with an avatar that might be a docent to lead you around the space. And finally, when you're within one of these systems, we have precise knowledge of where you are and what you've been doing in that space. We can record it if you want to keep track of that for any purpose. For example, I know that there is an effort underway to maybe recreate some of the art exhibits at the Academy Museum here. And one of the things we could do is if we make a virtual version of previous exhibits, we can put people in them and we can see how quickly people move past one painting versus another painting. Or if you want to experiment with putting up paintings in different orders, you can then bring in many people and see how they respond to it, collect that data, visualize it, and make an informed decision on how you might use this space. So we actually use this knowledge of a participant's movement to do cognitive studies, and I wanted to show you one example of that. Unfortunately, it's not an art history example, and I'm hoping to make the audio work, but I don't have the right kind of adapter. So this is actually an experiment we are doing on people who are prone to addiction, so people who smoke, are alcoholic, have addiction to drugs, crack cocaine. And we have a hypothesis that these people are more likely to avoid unpleasant situations. And so we made what is called the annoying kitchen, and I just want to show you this clip so that you can get a sense. All right, so I wanted you to get a sense of working in one of these worlds. Obviously, it's not at all photorealistic. We are constrained with having to draw our images at 100 times a second, so they have to be fairly simple models that we deal with and simple lighting models. But that shows you some interactivity going on. I also want to talk about a project that we haven't finished yet, but we have conceived. For example, something you might do in virtual reality is an issue faced by one of our faculty members, Sheila Dillon, and she studies sculpture, and she's trying to study sculpture in context. But one of the things she's dealt with, and all archaeologists are dealt with, is they find these fragments, and they want to put the fragments back into the kind of sculpture it may have come from. Well, one of the things you can use virtual reality for, both for research and for teaching, is we could use a 3D scanning method or photosynth to create 3D models of many fragments, populate a virtual world with them. Maybe we have fragments from Greece, maybe we have fragments from Italy and Rome, and we can bring students in and have the students pick up these fragments and put them back together in an example In an example statue, similarly to how Steve is manipulating these coins here. It's much easier to move these large marble fragments virtually than it is physically. So it gives you some 3D affordances in that sense. I also want to say that projection-based VR is not the only way to experience content human size. And there are many, many ways to make big displays, and it's relatively inexpensive these days to make large human scale size displays with what's called a tiled display, which is many small LCD screens put together into a tile. This just happens to be one. I thought I'd go ahead and run this little video showing another kind of interactivity. Now we're carrying nothing. We don't have on our stereo. We have no stereographics. But just using a camera and computer vision systems, where you stand in front of the display activates the display. This happens to be a gigapixel image viewer. So if you have a very large high-resolution image, this viewer will let you pan around that image, scale, and zoom relative to that. Come on, Todd. He walks around a little bit later, so you can kind of see it in action here. And the last thing I wanted to talk about today is we've been talking about the privilege of the vision, but in fact, there's a lot to learn from audio and aural interpretation of spaces. A few of the speakers alluded to this earlier today. Erica Sherman, who's a graduate student at Duke, did a little project with me where she used her 3D model for the geometry and put it into an acoustic analysis software. It's a software system called EASE, for any of you interested in this, out of Germany. And so she performed an acoustic analysis of the Sala della Musica, which was in the Ospedale Delta at the Campo of Paolo and John, and I can never pronounce it correctly, so I'm not even going to try. But the kinds of questions she asks is she knows that there was an architectural modification to the space. This particular space is where the orphans who stayed at the Ospedaletto would come in and give performances. They would usually be girls, and they would have a privacy screen. And she wanted to understand how the modifications of the space might have changed the acoustics. Were there acoustically privileged locations in the room? This seems to be a common question among historians, is finding these locations of privilege. And finally, what effect did the chastity screens have with the way the music sounded to the audience and the way the music sounded to the girls who were up in the balcony? So here's just a few slides. So did the architectural modifications of the Ospedaletto kitchens impact the acoustics of the space? And here is a reverberation graph over here on the left of the original space, which was very rectangular and rectilinear as it would have been originally considered to be ideal. This, of course, creates a very live space with a lot of echo. And the space was modified first by adding plaster to the brick walls and reed mats to the ceiling to increase the absorption capacity of the room. And second, they eliminated the corners and turned the room into this oval shape. And the curved walls ended up focusing the sound onto the audience plane, amplifying the acoustical experience of certain audience members. But I want to draw your attention to the difference in this reverberation graph from before. Whereas before we had a peak at these low frequencies, this is frequency in this axis and power in this axis. We do have a much better decay curve. This is closer to the ideal, which would be an exponential decay. And of course, Erica also did this analysis with and without the choir screen, and the metal screens were in fact highly reflective, though they were permeable. So with the installation of the screens, the sound pressure arrival time and clarity levels decreased slightly for the audience, because the screen, of course, obscured things. But it did, interestingly, reflect the energy back to the girls themselves, so they sounded better to themselves, like singing in the shower, it would have done. So in closing, I just want to leave you with a call to arms that 3D modeling is the beginning of many paths for object analysis, visualization, and display. That human-sized displays, large screens, are very powerful and a useful technology for historical research and communication of historical ideas. And finally, I want to emphasize that interactivity provides many affordances. Hopefully this talk showed some options available through the use, of course, of virtual reality technologies, but a similar argument can be made for augmented reality applications, the iPad applications, with the new web technologies coming on board with WebGL and HTML5, your ability to display and convey your 3D models in a very easy format is just going to get easier and easier and faster as time goes on. Thank you for your attention.
Anzitutto grazie per questa bellissima comunicazione che ho trovato estremamente affascinante, tanto da proporci anche nuovi campi di ricerca nel campo del suono e della musica.